We are about to start our next session, so while Michael Sussmann, Steve Slick, Giovanni Buttarelli, and Scott Charney make their way up, I think I'll just say two words by way of brief biographical introductions from them all. So about to be sitting to my left is Scott Charney. Scott is the corporate vice president for Microsoft's Trustworthy Computing Group, where he helps ensure the company's products and services comply with security and privacy standards. He leads Microsoft's engagement with governments, partners, and customers on security and privacy issues. And as all of you, I'm sure, know, Microsoft has taken a real leadership position on these issues, not only in the last several years, but for the last several decades. Sitting to his left, who you met earlier today, Giovanni Buttarelli, the European Union's data protection supervisor. To his left, Steve Slick, who was appointed in January 2015 as the director of UT Austin's Intelligence Studies Project. He's a clinical professor at the Lyndon B. Johnson School of Public Affairs. And before moving to Austin, Steve served 28 years in the CIA's clandestine service, including 5 assignments abroad. And then at the end of the table, Michael Sussmann, a partner at Perkins Coie's Washington office, a lawyer who has really tremendous experience both in and out of government with this set of issues. So what I wanted to do, we've got about 40, 45 minutes to speak among us here on the panel and then open it to you for questions, is just to say a few words by way of transition from this morning's session. So beginning with Jane Harmon and Mike Rogers, Sam Raskoff's panel, Deputy Director Cohen's remarks, the discussion this morning has focused predominantly on questions of domestic oversight in the United States. That is a vitally important piece of the picture to understand, but it's of course only a piece of the picture. And in the work we've done in the last several years with the Wilson Center, we've come to understand intelligence oversight in a richer and more multidimensional context. Rich talked about some of the ways in which the oversight ecosystem, at least among certain Western democracies, is starting to converge. Different institutions are emerging in different Western democracies that resemble each other or at least serve similar functions. But as I just noted, the oversight ecosystem is becoming incredibly complicated. Different types of actors are playing important roles in shaping and constraining the possibilities of intelligence, and that's what I hope that our discussion here this afternoon will bring to light. I think the new oversight landscape has 4 important characteristics. First, it's transnational. So Deputy Director Cohen spoke about the importance of liaison relationships and the influence that the United States intelligence community can have on other intelligence communities through those relationships. CIA Director John Brennan spoke about that same issue last year in greater depth, and Steve and I hope we'll engage in dialogue about what that actually looks like on the ground. Second, to be as nuanced as Scott would like me, private companies now are the repositories of enormous quantities of data about individuals all over the world and have a voice and a vote in the way in which governments can access that data in new ways. And Scott, I know, will illuminate some of the dynamics that are taking place in that space. Third, because of this new role for the private sector, different types of institutions, governmental institutions, are involved. Institutions like Giovanni's data protection supervisors in Europe and in Asia and in the United States, non-traditional agencies like the Federal Trade Commission are involved in intelligence governance in new ways. One only needs to look at the privacy shield agreement reached between the EU and the US a couple of months ago to understand the new importance of agencies like the Department of Commerce and the FTC. And finally, as I noted, Steve, I think, will weigh in on the importance of intelligence partnerships in a world that is in as much flux as Jane Harmon and Mike Rogers described this morning. And in important ways, the relationship and the need to cooperate among intelligence agencies influences oversight. So with that, I think I'll start by turning to Steve. So Steve, Deputy Director Coie spoke about the importance of partnerships, and I'm hoping you might elaborate on that, and in doing so, shed a little bit of light on the way in which our need for partnerships, our United States' need for partnerships, might or might not constrain us. David Coie spoke about the way in which other intelligence agencies' need for our cooperation and partnership can often have salutary benefits on their human rights compliance. And that's a mode of influence that hopefully leads to more rights protective intelligence. But does that vector of influence operate in the other direction? Are we constrained by our partnerships, or our partnerships just work to enable us?
Well, thank you very much, Zach. Those are interesting topics. First, let me just say thank you to you and Sam for the invitation. Your center, together with the Wilson Center, has put on a terrific conference, and I'm pleased to be part of it. And thanks for bringing attention to this important subject. It's absolutely essential to the efficacy and sustainability of the U.S. intelligence effort. So, Deputy Director Coie, I'm not sure if he helped me or supplanted what I intended to say. He spoke rather directly and eloquently about the value to U.S. intelligence of our, and I say our, that's a habit from almost three decades in the intelligence community. I should clarify, I'm a private citizen now and speak for myself alone, not for the intelligence community, even if I get the pronouns wrong. We, us, and our. In any event, it's absolutely true what he said, is that U.S. intelligence depends in this day and age critically on the support and assistance in many different ways that I can describe of our foreign partners. And there are a number of reasons for this, but let me first just sort of frame the constellation of relationships that we're talking about. As I mentioned last night to a group, this is not five, this is not 10, this is not dozens, it's not even hundreds. If you imagine the number of security services around the world in the 150 plus sovereign states, and imagine our own 16 intelligence agencies that we sustain, not including the ODNI, which would be 17, in the United States, you can imagine the sheer volume of relationships that the U.S. intelligence community maintains with internal security services, external services, civilians, military, police, border control, all the various services that exist in a foreign state with whom you would want your CIA or your U.S. intelligence community to have a relationship. So there are easily, without getting into numbers, you know, well over 1,000, maybe into several thousand of these relationships. But each one of them is unique. So some of them consist of little more than an exchange of holiday greetings between the directors once a year, or an analytic exchange where we trade notes on a general level with conditions underway in the given part of the world. But on the far end of that spectrum, the United States has a large number of intimate, trusting, alliance relationships with security services that are absolutely vital to accomplishing what the President and what the Congress and what the American people expect the intelligence community to do. So most of these are bilateral relationships. They tend to be point-to-point. There's an old expression in the intelligence community that, you know, getting along with one partner and getting something accomplished is hard enough. If you introduce a third country or a third partner service into the equation, it becomes almost impossible. Although there are several instances where there are regional or small collective security alliances where people have decided to work together for a common aim. They're not that many. And then there are several reasonably well-known multilateral organizations where intelligence and security services from different countries come together around a common objective. And Zach mentioned one of those, and that's the Five Eyes. These are the Commonwealth states together with the U.S. that succeeded in defeating the Axis in World War II and maintained their relationships through the Cold War. It's the Brits, the Australians, the Kiwis, and the Canadians. And this is probably the most elaborate, formalized, high-volume set of intelligence relationships in the world. Seems to be a club that lots of our European and other allies would like to join, although I don't think membership applications are available. So And these kinds of relationships at that far end of the spectrum include voluminous intelligence sharing to help each of the governments be better informed about areas they're concerned about, and also intimate operational cooperation. That can mean recruiting and handling agents, conducting technical operations together, sharing sources and methods, the most sensitive thing, most sensitive set of secrets we have in our community. So what are the reasons that the U.S. community needs to have these relationships, why they're so vital, and regrettably so little understood? The first is simply a matter of numbers and resources, and David alluded to this, so I don't know what the number is, but there are frankly not that many CIA and U.S. intelligence community officers deployed overseas, given the scope of the security challenges that we face, the transnational nature of counterterrorism, counter-narcotics, countering human smuggling, countering organized crime. So we simply need the help. You need all the eyes and ears, all the hands and feet that we can get to supplement the U.S. intelligence presence with capable foreign partners. Mm-hmm. And so by having these relationships, you, the U.S. taxpayers, have your safety enhanced by the work of thousands and thousands of highly capable, patriotic security officers working for foreign governments. And so it's absolutely necessary from a resource standpoint. Secondly, I'd say capabilities. David mentioned the possibility that we use our foreign liaison partners to help combat acts of terrorism. So if I'm in a country overseas and I discover that a suspected terrorist is going to land at the airport and I happen to work for the CIA and we want to stop this person and see what documents they're carrying, possibly question them, possibly send them off to a secondary inspection while their laptop computer is imaged to see what's on that, the CIA can't do any of this overseas. The CIA doesn't have law enforcement powers here in the United States and they certainly don't have them overseas. But if you have reliable internal partners with whom you've built relationships, trusting relationships, mutually beneficial relationships over many years, well, you can call them up, and they actually can arrest somebody at the airport, can conduct an interrogation, can carve away the person's laptop computer. And this is, frankly, how we combat terrorism in the world today, using U.S. information in many cases together with local sovereign authorities to prevent the travel and preparation and execution of acts of terrorism, okay? And then the last advantage that the U.S. gets out of these relationships is the unique linguistic and cultural, regional understanding and knowledge that they bring to problems. The world's a complicated place. We're separated by two oceans. We have great natural wealth within our population, but the fact of the matter is we rely extensively on the assistance of foreign governments. And I'll mention one in a positive way tonight, and that's the State of Israel, which is a great U.S. ally and also a superb intelligence power. And we have productive and important intelligence relationships with our Israeli counterparts. And it's vitally important to keeping America safe that we do, because they live in a different part of the world, understand it in different ways, and can help us have the nuanced understanding we need to convey to our policymakers. So while the U.S. Congress, the leaders of the U.S. intelligence community, frankly, the president, expects this intelligence community to be able to act unilaterally on its own with the considerable resources that we've been provided to gather the information needed to keep America safe, it's simply the case that we cannot perform this function unilaterally. We do rely on foreign assistance, and it's important that we recognize that and talk about it today from the standpoint of oversight and otherwise, because it's essential but little understood.
Good. Thank you, Steve. So Steve outlined a very important thumbnail sketch of the way in which we cooperate with our partner agencies around the world and maybe the importance of this in the oversight context. Scott, I'm going to turn to you next to talk about a new set of actors. So from the oversight perspective, what does effectively governed intelligence look like from the private sector's point of view?
Well, to think about it, I think you have to appreciate how the role of government vis-a-vis the internet has changed in the last 15 years. and then understand how a company like Microsoft or any of the big IT providers think about this problem. Now, I was in the Justice Department doing computer crimes in the 90s, and the government's approach to the internet was laissez-faire, hands-off. It was an engine for economic growth and employment, great innovation, and then, of course, the crime problem followed. And if you look today, governments have four distinct roles with the internet. First of all, they're just large enterprises. They're customers or citizens, but they want everyone to be connected, doing online tax filings and healthcare benefits. And like any large enterprise, they look at the IT industry and say, help us secure our systems. And they struggle, as all of industry does, with how to secure these wildly distributed, heterogeneous systems. And you see a lot of government breaches and private sector breaches. Second, they are also responsible for protecting the security of the internet. So you see discussion about critical infrastructure protection, as well as the security and privacy of internet users. And so in that context, they think about their regulatory authority or incentivizing markets to do the right thing. The third role is they exploit the internet. And if you think this is in conflict with their responsibility to protect it, the answer is yes. President Obama, in dealing with the issue of zero-day vulnerabilities, those are vulnerabilities that vendors are not aware of, came out and said, we have a bias for defense and we share vulnerabilities with industry unless we don't. And that is literally what he said. He said, if we have a national security or public safety reason, we might not share it. And then Michael Daniel, the cybersecurity coordinator, wrote a great blog explaining how the equities process works. And then fourth, of course, governments want access to data, lots of data. For intelligence purposes, law enforcement purposes, the encryption debate, and the like. So government has these four roles. And of course, in this context, too, there is, you know, a change in the IT environment. Everyone is moving to the cloud, which means you don't hold your own data close to you anymore. It's held by providers. The Internet of Things is here. There are, you know, billions of sensors and devices being attached to the internet, which causes defensive people to say, how are we going to secure this? And offensive people to say, yeah, how are you going to secure this? And you have to remember, for a mass market commercial vendor of IT, when one country attacks another country, whether it be an espionage program or a cyber military operation, for us, that's one customer attacking another customer. And either customer might ask us for support and help. And that's why, you know, for us, we have to, you know, be Switzerland. We have to do defense and not offense. And when governments either abuse our products, Stuxnet exploited 4 zero-days in Windows and led to us having to patch the entire planet, or come to us with court orders, the challenge is that it, depending on the oversight and the regimes and international discussions, it undermines trust in the value of the global information technology supply chain. And you can see, for example, in a post-Snowden world, how upset, you know, people were and concerned countries were about using American products. Yes, there's always been tension. The U.S. doesn't want to use Huawei products, and the Chinese are worried about American products, but even allies and countries that are generally friendly to the U.S., like you can look post-Snowden at the reaction in Germany, poses huge pressure on American companies to make sure that they are doing the right things in principled ways, and wherever possible can push for openness and transparency. I don't mean all the time. Yes, intelligence operations are not going to be publicly run, but you do need oversight mechanisms that give people trust in the global ICT supply chain. I'll leave you with this number, 4.5%. That is the percentage of the world population in the United States. The next 2 billion people coming online will not be here. It will be elsewhere. For all companies in the United States, our economic success is heavily dependent on us being able to win in foreign markets. And that is dependent on trust. And trust is dependent on whether or not your customers think you have their interests in mind or you're working for a particular government. And so when we think of these oversight issues. You know, in the criminal cases, of course, we're a big fan of court orders. We don't engage in bulk collection programs. We require specific accounts to be named. We are litigating cases where appropriate. In the intelligence environment, it is, of course, different in the sense that we may get orders, but we get non-disclosure orders. And you have to be able to discuss that with your customers overseas and explain to them how they should think about the problem, which is government access is essentially a business risk. If you're in a certain line of business where other governments may be interested in you, then that's a risk that you have to manage. On the other hand, you might be in a business that has nothing to do with anything of interest to governments. And so, because I talk to customers, they go, oh, I saw these Snowden disclosures, and I'm concerned about running American products. And sometimes for some of those customers, they're running Windows XP, which is out of support, and their networks are wide open. And you have to say to them, what are you more worried about, hackers stealing your intellectual property or the U.S. government coming after you? It's a business risk. Depends what business you're in. But for us, having as much transparency and openness as possible is critically important, and having rigorous processes that make sure that people's rights to privacy and security are being respected is critically important.
Thanks, Scott. Scott, maybe I'll pick up the theme of trust that you talked about, and maybe turn to Michael. There's no secret that the bonds of trust between the U.S. government and some members of the technology and telecommunications community have been damaged in the last several years. It's a little bit more difficult to think about what might be done to restore those bonds of trust. I was hoping you might talk about that a little bit from the vantage point you have of representing these kinds of companies.
Yeah, so it's tough. And Scott's here representing Microsoft. Scott, I think you're probably the first panelist or speaker of the day from the private sector, although the private sector is so vital to all these discussions. And companies' views of the government and their degree of trust vary across the spectrum. Microsoft is in one place, but other companies are in other places. Some of them have to do with the length of time they've been around to develop relationships. There are some very important tech companies that are also very new. And trust now is, I don't know if there's a barometer to say it's at an all-time low, but it's at a very low point. And the government struggles with it, recognizes it, and needs to make it better. And I think transparency in several forms is a particularly important and vital tool for making that better. A number of companies, Microsoft included, now issue transparency reports about the number and the kinds of law enforcement and national security legal process they receive, and there's litigation from a number of companies to try and get more transparency in that regard. And another kind of transparency I've seen are more briefings by the intelligence community to companies to explain exactly what they need data for and what they're being used for. That's not public transparency, but there's a degree to which that the companies that are receiving the requests need the trust of the public because they are acting on their behalf in many instances. There's a lot of information that can't be revealed, and I think people are making decisions when they decide which service to use about which companies they're going to trust to best protect their interests. And so companies are doing more. Not all of that is visible, but I've seen more and more briefings I would not have seen before from FBI or NSA or CIA on this is what this lawful order is for, this is what we're doing with it, this is the data that we've received from you before, or these are the people using your service. This is so-and-so using the service. Here's a picture of the individual. Here's what this person does. Here are the communications that are going on. And so more openness wherever possible is important. Obviously, there's not going to be complete transparency between the classified and important work the intelligence community does, but more is better, and the trend has to continue.
Great. I'd like to turn to Giovanni. So as companies have become more integrated into the fabric of intelligence in the last decade or more, and as these companies in turn act globally in the way that Scott has described, They become subject, this is not new in itself, but it's, I think, having important impact. They become subject to conflicting legal regimes and different legal regimes around the world, including with respect to data privacy and things like that. So I was hoping first you might just describe a little bit what your agency does and its counterparts across the European Union. And then second, talk a little bit about how you see your role vis-a-vis intelligence. There have been a number of high-profile agreements and disagreements between the EU data protection authorities, US government, a series of court cases in the last year in which the European Court of Justice has intervened directly in the data sharing relationships between the US and the EU. So talk a little bit about those dynamics and the role that you see your agency playing in that space.
Well, let me first make a short remark to say that I'm impressed about the way in which this qualified audience is following in full silence and following every word of such an interesting debate. So it means that today's conference is working very, very well. I will make some references to the European Union framework, but also with the flavor of what we do together with other privacy enforcement authorities around the globe in the framework, particularly of the GPEN infrastructure, or in any event, in terms of multilateral cooperation with other privacy commissioners in the third countries. In the EU, we have not yet the United States of Europe. European Union, as you know, is a supranational entity. It has been established 7 years ago, so it's still a young entity, and it is not competent for all. This is not exactly the kind of relationship you have here in between federal and state levels, meaning, for instance, with regard to intelligence, that EU is not competent for national intelligence. But as said in one of the European Data Protection Supervisor opinion, can be, and perhaps is, competent in case one of the member states starts engaging in activities in breach of the founding values of the European Union. And therefore, NGOs, activists, started by saying that, for instance, members of the 5As can be, subject to a scrutiny by the EU, depending on what the activity is. Another conclusion we raise in full agreement with Parliament, Council, and Commission is that we are competent with regard to national intelligence within third countries, provided it has an impact on individuals in the EU or companies working in the EU. So although the legal frameworks is relatively new, we are discovering step by step interesting developments. And for those interested to analyze what Europe can do in terms of intelligence, there are two extremely important conclusions of the Council of the European Council, which is the summit of the heads of state and government. It's not the meeting of the ministers of home affairs and justice. So we are speaking about the top in terms of leadership in the EU. And right after the first round of Snowden revelation, and then in November 2014, they declared in public a commitment to work intensively in terms of restoring trust and with a view to discuss also with strategic partners in the world, namely the United States, on how we can better work together in that perspective, provided that there are many dossiers in this transatlantic dialogue which directly or indirectly are relevant and are affected. The negotiations on TTIP and TISA, where there is an up and down with regard of questions directly or indirectly relevant by data protection viewpoint, trade secrets, cloud computing activities, dispute resolutions and mechanisms, but also the transfer of data, the umbrella agreement, the privacy shield, the future of other bilateral agreements such as those on passenger name records, on TFTP, so financial data. So the solution is fragmented in terms of specific recommendations, but it is unique in general terms. Data protection authorities have to be necessarily and firmly independent. There are three rulings from the Court of Justice condemning Germany, Hungary, and Austria, and if you read the three all together, you will see why in the regulation, so the new federal law for the EU to be published in June, strengthened the independence of DPAs. And that's an important element to understand the criticality now in the current debate, privacy versus security, since intelligence may be tempted to say, I don't want to be subject to, I mean, the vision of an administrative body such as the DBA. And although they are independent from both the government and the legislative power, they are not courts, and therefore we are a little bit reluctant. We much more prefer to have perhaps a parliamentary oversight mechanism. You may also identify at least three different categories of member states. Those where the intelligence activity de facto is not regulated, is an elephant in the room, so you assume that they exist. There are provisions concerning the establishment of the intelligence, but it is not very well regulated in detail what they can do, what is lawful and what is not. And this is extremely problematic and controversial, since the Court of Human Rights has clearly established that any intelligence activity is to based on accessible law and is to be foreseeable. And therefore, don't be surprised to see the recent comments by Article 29 Working Party, the group of data protection authorities, with regard to the kind of details you may see in the US, in the PPD 28, in the Executive Order 12333, because of course we appreciate the efforts in terms of selectivity. It's a strong signal which helps a lot, but it does not coincide 100% of what is required in the EU. And the ruling by the Constitutional Court of Germany, I mentioned this morning, is exactly working in this perspective. A second group of European countries has, provisions to regulate in practice what intelligence can do. There is a mini group of countries where it is detailed in practice what is lawful, and therefore they have a legal basis for very invasive activities, while in other countries, such as the country of my origin, it is not said in practice what they could do, but in case they perform invasive activities, including those in terms of surveillance, they are not punished because of the legitimate purpose. A third group of countries is subject to a detailed scrutiny by data protection authorities and by courts. And in the large majority of member states, and this is also the result of the post-communist effect, interception activities are to be subject, even for intelligence, to a prior authorization by a court. It could be a centralized court, as it is, again, for my country of origin, or, I mean, diffuse cores. All in all, there are, a group of seven plus nine member states, so 16 out of 28, where data protection authorities, in a way or in another one, so in full or partially, perform supervisory powers over intelligence activity. I did it for 12 years as a Secretary General of my national data protection authorities. I had, a chance to have full access to every kind of super classified information. And I will start with a short anecdote to say that I've been asked at that time by my government to draft the Data Protection Act. And intelligence reacted when it was so late, when the bill was passed by the government and submitted to the parliament, and they started asking to be excluded from the scope of application. The government then insisted because they had already ratified a Council of Europe convention, and I think we squared the circle in the sense that we have identified the right modalities to give much more legitimacy to those activities, because the way in which principles in terms of quality, in terms of proportionality, in terms of fairness are applied to a business company and to intelligence can vary. Therefore, the mere application of this principle doesn't mean that you are affected. So supervisory powers are exercised. And on top of that, there are many judgments from the two courts I have mentioned. They require, pre-requirements in terms of fairness. So the activities, for instance, of UK mentioned this morning, and even the bill submitted to the Parliament. Can be passed politically, but perhaps is critical by a court viewpoint. So it seems a fragmented framework, but we are working hard to reconcile and ensure much more harmonization. The final conclusion relates to the full competence of data protection authorities over business companies, and here we scrutinize the purpose limitation principle. One thing is, as you said, a limited access to a limited set of data with regard to a specific investigation, and data protection authorities never created any problem. One thing is the massive and routinary access to categories of information to be made accessible without transparency to data subject. This is an issue 100% under the supervisory powers of DBAs, and therefore the kind of comments made over the draft privacy shield, where there are recommendations on the commercial part but also on surveillance, so there is a legal analysis on the US system, not to say we do it better in the EU, but to say if you would like to allow the 3,900 companies from the EU to transfer on a regular basis data to the US, and we assume that then this data will be accessible by routine by law enforcement agencies and intelligence in the US, you have to offer some safeguards which may be considered sustainable in the US, but they do not comply 100% on our criteria. So globalization is also harmonization of different legal approaches. And if we speak about privacy bridges, we need to consider that a solid bridge, is based on two equal pillars. So we need not to overstate in the EU, but we need of improvements in the US.
Thank you very much. So I wanted to just, Steve, I'm going to put you on the spot in a minute to talk a little bit about transparency and how exactly it is, you know, Scott and Michael emphasize the importance of transparency to rebuilding trust. How does that work in the intelligence space? It's not, food inspection where you can have a totally transparent set of rules, or is it? But Giovanni, I wanted to just follow up. You made this morning a remark I want to make sure first I understood it correctly, but then I think you said only 5 of 28 EU member states have detailed regulations on targeted versus untargeted surveillance. So what I understood that to mean is only 5 of 28 EU member states actually govern in some measure of detail when countries, when their intelligence services rather can engage in targeted versus untargeted surveillance. I would assume the default is that for the rest of the 23, they can sort of do what they want. Is that right? And if that's right, then how do you assess from the perspective of foreseeability, the criteria that you said the ECHR has set out, the US's set of rules in that regard versus the European countries' rules?
The conclusion that that only 5 EU countries have detailed rules to, analyze specifically what it means targeted, what it means bulk, doesn't mean that the others do not have rules or do not have criteria to be respected. Particularly from the huge number of judgments by the two courts, the European courts, we not speaking about other national courts, for instance, from Germany and Romania, we understand what they did. We understand what they've been requested to do as a result of the European court case, and therefore perhaps the gap is in the existence of details in the law, but perhaps soft. Regulation, soft legislation, directives such as the PPD 28 are in any event in place. So I was referring this morning particularly on primary law, so the
statutory law.
It is also a recent phenomenon, and partly emerged before Snowden, but largely after. So we too are part of this work in progress.
So Steve, David Cohen spoke a lot about the need for transparency. Jim Clapper, the Director of National Intelligence, has basically said, we're living in an open world, get used to it. What does that mean from the perspective of an intelligence officer?
Shocking.
How much does it scare you is really the question.
A lot, but I'm of a generation and there are new generations in store. So let me say a couple things about that. First, I'm conflicted and I'll confess to that as to what my ultimate views are on that transparency initiative underway. I'm not even sure that transparency is the right word choice for the director and his program. I'll borrow from one of my colleagues who's here today without embarrassing him, works at the CIA and helps to implement this. He prefers the word openness, which I think conveys a slightly different sentiment and maybe a little closer to what's actually transpiring. And then a common friend of many of ours, Michael Leiter, who is one of the directors of the National Counterterrorism Center, has coined the phrase translucent. Not fully transparent, not completely open, but you get to see a little bit, a little hide and seek. So I'm not even sure what the right word is, and if you don't understand the right title for the program, you're not likely to execute it particularly successfully. I understand and sympathize completely with the sense of the intelligence community leaders that in the wake of the Snowden revelations and some legitimate public concern, legitimate concern within the administration and the Congress about some of the mass surveillance programs, that there was a need to rebuild trust with the American people. No bureaucratic institution can survive long without the trust and confidence of the people. That's simply a democratic norm. And so I understand why they've done it. I think there's nothing at all wrong, and there might even be utility in, for example, releasing some of the legal opinions more quickly that underlie these technical intelligence programs. I think that's useful. I think a small group of academics and members of the public are interested in 40-year-old PDBs. That may be released at presidential libraries and discussed and form research material for graduate student papers. But none of that really gets at what the American people, I think, and many of our overseas partners are interested in understanding about U.S. intelligence, and that's how it actually takes place and what it means for them individually as a state and as an individual. And I simply don't think that level of detail is going to be compatible with effective intelligence operations, with how to remain secret. So I'm, in regard to the impact, I certainly can't hurt. I think it's sincere and well-intentioned. I'm skeptical that it will actually buy a great deal of benefit for the community next time there's a controversy, and there will be future controversies in intelligence. I'm not sure the reservoir of public support will be significantly deeper because of the kinds of things that are being released and explained and talked about in connection with this transparency program. Now, in that regard, so if we need trust, we have a trust deficit with the public to some degree, and we need to restore trust. And some of the measures, the self-help measures that the intelligence community has identified themselves and is sincerely executing. So how do we rebuild that trust? And in that regard, I look principally, and I don't mean this as a overly partisan remark, but an observation of fact, is that the elected representatives of the American people who do benefit daily from the intelligence that our community collects, the insights that are made available to them, the covert action programs that they can direct. That's principally the President and the U.S. Congress, I think, bear overriding responsibility for explaining U.S. intelligence to the American people, explaining why it's necessary to keep us safe, explaining the measures they've approved for that community to gather the information needed to keep us safe, and frankly, to stand up and take the heat. If something that they have approved or was undertaken under their authority was inconsistent with what the American public expected. And so there's simply no substitute when you're a secret intelligence organization, have global responsibilities, take risks every day, for having the full-throated support in times of need from the U.S. President and the U.S. Congress. People who are in touch with the people know what their concerns are. If we're doing it right, we're informed about what the intelligence, fully and currently informed about what the intelligence community was doing, and I think it's their obligation to stand up and defend this community in that instance.
Thank you. Scott, I'd like to turn to you for a second and ask for your reflections on, from the perspective of transparency, how the and Giovanni's sort of criteria of accessibility and foreseeability, how the U.S. stacks up against some of its partners or allies or non-allies, frenemies, whatever you want to identify, and in terms of the detailed nature of the law, and if you have a model in mind, what is it, and what does that model look like in terms of the authorities that intelligence communities have vis-a-vis private companies?
Yeah, so I think Stuart Baker was right when he testified before Congress and said, you know, for the most part, the United States has the most regulated intelligence community in the world. You know, and I've been in countries where I've talked to, you know, members of their government who were complaining to me in the post-Snowden revelation, and I would say, you know, in your country, for example, Vice, statute, your government can monitor 40% of the capacity of the telephone network. And assuming there's enough redundancy in the network, that means you can almost take the whole thing. And the reality is that the oversight for that process was, in this country, an executive branch oversight. There was no, you know, oversight by the elected officials. And I was talking to an elected official, I said, so how confident are you that you understand what your own government is doing? And the response was, it's not a problem. I trust my government. You know, there are places in the world where, you know, look, we have three branches of government all designed to watch over each other because, you know, as Madison said, when wrong can be done, it will be. And then we have the press to monitor the three branches of government in case they ever collude together. Right? And so our foundations are very different than in some other countries where governments are more paternalistic in the eyes of the people themselves. In fact, you know, we've had a crypto debate before. We had it in the 90s, and I was head of the U.S. delegation to the OECD in Paris on cryptography guidelines, and a French professor came up to me and said, I don't understand why there's all this contention about key escrow. I know people are worried about who hold the keys. Why doesn't the U.S. government offer to hold the keys? Then everyone will be happy. And I asked him if he had ever been to America, and not surprisingly, he had not been. So as a practical matter, we do have a lot of oversight, but that doesn't necessarily mean that the U.S. government is doing enough things to ensure that America is competitive around the world. No one is suggesting, when we talk about transparency and intelligence activities, that people disclose sources and methods or specific operations. But even, you know, listening to Stephen a little bit, I get it completely. I was in the government for a long time. It's about getting, you know, explaining to the American people how these things work. No, it's about explaining to the worldwide population how these things work. You know, it's not the American people who are abandoning American products. It's not the American populace that will undermine American competitiveness in that way. It's our, you know, friends and frenemies and others, enemies, who may be dependent on U.S. products today, and they don't know enough about how these systems are architected, what the protections are in place, what kinds of oversight are in place, and it's not explained to them in a way that gives them comfort. I mean, look, no one would suggest that governments not protect their national security, but the surveillance of Angela Merkel's cell phone creates a different kind of problem, you know? And when the president comes out and says, we're not going to do that anymore, you know, what's the reaction of the German populace to that? You know, and you, at the Munich Security Conference, I had, you know, German technology companies saying to me, in Germany we have world-class engineers. Think BMW, Audi, Siemens, and the like. We missed the IT wave. We can't get back in. Now we can. Now we can, because Silicon Valley had captured ICT and the cloud. And, you know, it was just a juggernaut of innovation and features and functionality. And now there was a wedge issue that allows foreign suppliers to say, here's a reason you don't want to be in American products. They're in bed with the U.S. government. This is one of the reasons for 14 years we've been sharing our source code with governments all over the world. Because they would say, how can we run American products in our infrastructure? You must have a back door for the NSA. We said, no, we don't put back doors in our products. We do defense, not offense. And by the way, we'll share our code with you. People were astounded when we did it. There are companies still today that said, you never should share your source code. That's the crown jewels. Really, it was about trust. If other places in the world don't understand how the U.S. government works and thinks, for example, that it is okay for the U.S. government to put back doors in American information technology products and believes that American companies will aid the U.S. government because we're taking sides in this, you know, global geopolitical environment, then you don't have a business model that survives in a global economy where most of your revenue comes from overseas. And so what we do need is good explanations about how the system works generally, what oversight is there, and how the system is designed to prevent abuse and misuse, but that also has to be communicated more than just to the U.S. population.
Yeah, so I think the global dimension is critical, and in that regard, I want to turn to Michael, and then I think we've unfortunately got about 10 minutes left. We'll turn to questions, so if you've got them, please start lining up in a moment in the aisle. But Michael, I wanted to talk to you a little bit about the privacy shield, something I'm sure Giovanni has spent a lot of the last little while working on, but from the perspective of private industry. So the brief sort of thumbnail, just give us a little bit about sort of what this is and how it emerged from the safe harbor and the Schrems decision, and how companies, given the let's call it, somewhat lukewarm reaction with which it's been treated by some of Giovanni's colleagues in various data protection authorities around the world, how companies are starting to manage the uncertainty coming from data privacy laws and regulation around the world.
Sure. So for many, many years, there was a free flow of data between the United States and Europe. And in the 90s, following the data protection work in Europe, the EU worked out with our Commerce Department Safe Harbor. And Safe Harbor is one of three ways that companies in the United States could, quote unquote, safely transfer data between the United States and Europe: Safe Harbor, binding corporate rules, or model contracts. That's been around for, let's say, 20 years, and then the decision of the European Court of Justice that said that, and I'm, Giovanni, I'm really giving the simplified version with apologies. But the European Court of Justice said, in part because of intelligence activities that were disclosed, that Safe Harbor is no longer an adequate protection. And the decision came sort of very quickly. It was maybe expected for a short period of time, but just like that, and you had, I think you said 3,900 countries, I thought it was 4,400 companies, but a lot of US companies were relying on a Safe Harbor, the Safe Harbor certified, and I think it was a Tuesday the decision comes down, then everyone calls and says, like, what do we do now? And first and foremost, the view in US industry about this and a number of other issues is it is a governmental problem, and companies are caught in the middle of it. Companies want to comply. They want to do whatever they, assuming they can do with regard to Safe Harbor, and it's a problem for the governments to resolve, and it creates uncertainty. I think the one thing that, the one bit in the, of the one issue in the short term where there wasn't uncertainty was that, candidly, non-compliance while this was figured out was not going to be enforced. So the companies that on Tuesday found out about the decision were not going to stop their business on Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. Maybe a surprise to you. And wait and see how it comes out. And so I think Privacy Shield, I think it came about more quickly than companies might have thought. And I think initially companies thought this was going to be uncertain for a long time. I think there's still uncertainty as to how it will be resolved. But it's a problem for governments to solve, just like conflicts of laws. We talked about the conflicts of laws are problems really that are there for governments to solve, where companies find themselves in the middle. Companies don't want the problems. They're generally willing to comply, and they're generally looking to comply with the law. They're put in a difficult situation, and they're waiting for things to be resolved and be resolved in a reasonable way.
Giovanni, you had a point you wanted to make.
No, I fully agree. Just to say that I had the honor to be among the negotiators of the Safe Harbor, which is not bad good news because it means I'm not anymore so junior as I would like to be. But at that time, we were not 100% satisfied. Then for years and years, we insisted for making Safe Harbor effective. And Safe Harbor, unfortunately, entered into, I mean, sort of dead waters, and this is why 2013 the European Commission recommended 13 improvements. But then the Court of Justice arrived first before the conclusion of ongoing negotiation. I said 13,900 because 400 companies seem to now more efficiently apply other legal instruments such as binding corporate rules or standard contractor clauses. My question is that this interaction in between security and business demonstrates that, of course, there is an issue of trust, there is an issue of efficiency of secrecy, but there is an issue of also of global balance of different concerns if we want companies being effective. And many companies have to transfer data from Europe to the US. The opinion on the Privacy Shield by the 28 national authorities, first of all, recognized that the US system on intelligence is based on law, so it's lawful. And there is a sentence that is sufficiently foreseeable. So there are some references to the lack of clarity to certain expressions, such as signal intelligence, expressions where we say it should, intelligence activities should be tailored as much as possible, what it means when you have technical obstacles or for other reasons. Not speaking about the notion of foreign intelligence information when they speak about information with respect to a foreign power or a foreign territory that relates to the conduct of foreign affairs of the United States. So it's everything and nothing at the same time. But okay, the main concerns are on necessity and proportionality, and on, I mean, what it means targeted collection and how we can better reconcile the necessary intelligence activities in the U.S., which is key for many countries in the world, and I fully agree, compatible with, I mean, the legal system of one of the other strategic partners. So I think we have closed now the first round of the relevant negotiations. It is difficult to predict what would happen. I will adopt my opinion by early May. Even the European Parliament is likely to adopt a resolution by the 9th, 10th of May. And then, I mean, the European Commission has to take a decision. And the decision will be relevant for business at global level, for cloud computing, for big data, for commerce, for many, I mean, activities at international level. So we really have to work all together to better understand each other.
Great, thank you. One question or no?
Hi, yeah, I just had a quick question. Michael, you got into something with the safe harbor and talking about businesses willing to be compliant, you know, and their willingness, but they need to have like a certain level of standards. They need to know what they're being compliant with. There's a number of different guidelines, whether it be NIST or the C2M2 the Department of Energy has. Is there any kind, I'm wondering if there's any that you view as better or worse? I know there's no national or international standard, but is there any framework that you recommend a company be compliant to? That's in general for the panel.
Just compliant domestically for their own best practices or in anticipation of EU regulation?
In terms of best practices.
For cybersecurity, NIST and ISO mostly, and then you know, the NIST cybersecurity framework was a great thing. It's obviously voluntary, but it's pretty thorough. And I think generally we're doing things now that are compliant with both. We cross-reference between the other. The SANS 20 is always very important to look at, but NIST is pretty detailed, and there's a lot of attention. It's not sort of like it's a living standard. It's going to be improved, and so we think that's a great starting place. And it also is written in a very accessible way for people at non-technical levels to read it and try and follow it. So we like NIST.
Can I add, as a IT vendor, if you want to sell, you're going to have lots of standards. You want to sell to the banks, you need SOX, Basel II. You want to sell into healthcare, you need HIPAA. You want to sell into any regulated industry, you need ISO 27001 series. If you want to sell to the federal government for cloud services, you need FedRAMP. For box product, you need common criteria and a whole range of nations. If you want to sell in China, you better follow the GB standards. If you want to sell in Russia, you have to follow the NDF certifications. There are certifications all over the world. You can go to any major cloud provider and look up on their website. You will see they have dozens and dozens of certifications, and it's required to sell.
Great. Thank you.
I think I'll just ask one more question and sort of to the group and sort of invite your reflections. Pivoting off of something Scott said, the next 2 billion internet users are going to be from outside the United States. Companies like yours, Apple, Google, et cetera, I think all see themselves as global companies. Foreign intelligence is and remains a national enterprise. And as far as I'm aware, every country in the world draws distinctions between the rights that it affords to their own citizens and those outside of their country. And so, sort of to all of you, what does this world look like 5-10 years from now when every major tech company is a global company and every foreign intelligence service is still a foreign intelligence service with respect to the rest of the world?
So I think you have to separate out two different kinds of intelligence activity because it really makes a difference. With regard to orders, when you get FISA orders and other kinds of intelligence orders, you know, global companies have to honor the laws in every country where they do business. And if they get orders, you know, there are times we fight orders. We're in the courts now, as you may know, in the Second Circuit over a search warrant for some data from our Irish data center and the like. But as a general rule, you know, companies don't get to decide whether or not they're going to honor the court orders of various sovereign states, right? At the end of the day, there are only three options. You honor the order, you're held in contempt, and your people can be arrested, or you have to leave the country. I mean, those are the options. That's just being practical. There's another element of intelligence collection, though, that doesn't involve going to any provider directly and doing surveillance on products, hacking products, surveilling networks, and other kinds of things. In that context, it's easy because any IT vendor who has commercial mass product as we do will say we have to protect the confidentiality, integrity, and availability of data and systems. That is the definition of computer security. And what that means in practice is that anyone who is engaging activities that breaches those attributes is a threat. And our responsibility is to prevent those threats and keep customers secure. So that's why in light of the Snowden disclosures, you know, the debate is really interesting. If you go back to the clipper chip debate, for those of you old enough to remember, it was actually the US military that turned the tide when John Hamley, the Deputy Secretary of Defense, said it was more important to promote encryption than to, you know, restrict it. And at that time, the debate was over export controls, because export controls was limiting the spread of cryptography, and therefore it wasn't in major products. And at that time, the other parts of the government said, boy, if we relax export controls, there's going to be this flood of encryption, and we're going to go dark. Not just communication surveillance, because I was in the Justice Department at the time. I was actually more worried about search warrants, because at that time, the government only did 1,000 wiretaps a year. You can get the number from the Office of U.S. Courts. But search warrants were all the time, and you were going to lose all this communications and all this stored data. Well, the government decided to relax export controls on cryptography, and cryptography just went nowhere. Didn't spread. Why? It's hard to manage. Cryptography is hard to do. It's even harder to do right. It's hard to manage the keys. It's hard to ensure recovery for business data and for people's photos and everything else. And the reality is it never took off until the Snowden disclosures. Once the Snowden disclosures happened, everybody around the world was saying, oh my God, we can't trust your products. So everybody said, okay, we got to encrypt everything everywhere, right? And then suddenly law enforcement says they're going dark again 20 years later. But that's the way it played out. And so, you know, to the extent intelligence communities without any court orders walking into the door just saying we're going to try and break into a computer. Well, we fix our vulnerabilities when we know of them. Or we're going to try and surveil communications. No, we're going to encrypt from, you know, between the customer and us and between our data centers. That is a reaction to protecting the CIA, confidentiality, integrity, and availability of data. The last thing I do want to say about this, because there was a lot of discussion about encryption this morning, you know, there aren't, I don't think, many technologists in the room. But it's important to understand that one of the reasons that this debate sometimes gets a little funky is that the technologists and the people who write keys under doormats and talk about the weakening of crypto and the policy wonks and the lawyers and others are talking past each other a little bit. If you listen to some of the discussion, there are those who say we need to find a middle ground, right? The problem for a technologist is encryption is binary. Okay, it's either breakable or not breakable. Where's your middle ground? It's a one or a zero. That's all it can be. When policy people say we need a middle ground, what they're saying is, let's assume for a moment crypto is breakable. The middle ground is when do we get the data and when do we not? And then you don't hear them discussing the technical challenges of actually fixing the problem that they claim they want to fix. So what I mean by that is, with a device, you have a phone, you have a laptop, whatever, there's a key that may be associated with that device and a trusted platform module, which is a security chip. And at the time of manufacture, you might be able to say, let's take that device ID and that key and escrow it somewhere. But in communications, there's this thing called perfect forward secrecy. One of the problems with communications is if you break a key, you can listen to all the communications that ever used that key. Can't do that anymore. With perfect forward secrecy, every communication has its own key. Do you know how many billions of communications there are every day? Have you thought at all about where you're going to store these billions and billions of keys and match each key up to each communication, right? So the problem is this is actually a very, what we have to have is a very nuanced discussion and not a PR, you know, talking point discussion. It's a very hard problem. But for us, the encryption being everywhere is a way to protect the CIA of our customers, which is what we're committed to doing.
Good. Anything else? No. Thank you very much.